She's a full professor in applied mathematics at Arizona State University. She published the first set of mechanistic models addressing photoreceptor degeneration, providing a new framework to mitigate blindness. Her leadership, scholarship, and mentoring have won her numerous national and regional recognitions, including the 2019 AAAS Mentor Award, the 2014 PAESMEM Award from the White House, the 2020 AWM Louise Hay Award for Mathematics Education, the 2018 AAHHE Outstanding Latino Faculty in Higher Education Research and Teaching Award, the 2017 Great Minds in STEM Education Award, the 2012 SOCNAS Distinguished Mentoring Award, and the 2011 Hispanic Women's Corporation National Latina Leadership Award. She's won a 2013-2014 MLK Visiting Assistant Professorship of Mathematics at Massachusetts Institution of Technology. So as you can see, our distinguished speaker has many accolades, but she also has a very interesting and intriguing personal story, which I'm excited for her to tell us about today as well. So without further ado, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and invite Professor Camacho to proceed with her talk. Thank you so much, Professor Camacho. We're really happy to have you here.
Thank you very much, Emile. Just call me Tatiana or Erica. It's an honor to be here. It's really, truly an honor. I'm in the middle of moving. I slept very little, but I wanted to be prepared for this talk. I wanted to do both a little bit of my research and a little bit of my personal story. So I'll start a little bit with my research talk and and this is collaborative work with many individuals. So I wanna make sure that I give credit to them, especially the women that have worked in this work with me. Wait a minute, why am I not able to see my, oh, there we go. Bear with me for a minute. And so I'll be talking about the role of cone metabolism to mitigate blindness. As I say, this is a collaborative work. It involves various people, but I want to highlight mainly Dr. Danielle Barger, which is my, she was my PhD student, now she's a postdoc at NIST. And also Dr. Anka Radoska, Dr. Atanaska Torrebrera, Dr. Camille Lapari, Dr. Dina Smish and Dr. Imelda Trejo, who have worked with me in a different project, and we're about to submit for publication our second paper. And so I'm just, I'm part of that group, and I'm really happy to be working with them. So the main motivation for the work I undertake is really to try to mitigate blindness, to try to bring in in silico research and mathematical modeling to be able to give different insight and be able to identify certain mechanisms that have not been identified in the wet lab. And the main thing that we're trying to target is photoreceptor degeneration. And because once photoreceptors degenerate, there is no spontaneous birth of photoreceptors. And since they're responsible for creating absorbing the electrical signals and sending the signals to the brain, there is, once we lose them, we lose sight. And in particular, this happens when you have an untreated retina detachment, as well as age-related macular degeneration, which is the leading cause of vision loss in older individuals. And that accounts for 8.7% of the blindness worldwide. Also diabetic retinopathy, which is up in the increase due to a lot of diabetes cases that are on the rise. And also retinitis pigmentosa, which is the leading cause of inherited blindness. And it affects 1.5 million people worldwide. So it's really trying to come up. Currently, there is no cure for any of these diseases. Once you have it and it's already progressing enough, you just slowly start to lose your sight. So we want to be able to bring some kind of insight into that. Wait a minute, why is my screen? Now it's frozen. Oops, sorry about that. There we go. So really, I'm going to focus on the age-related macular degeneration and RP, retinitis pigmentosa. And in both of them, like I said, in the age-related macular degeneration, it really affects the fovea, the central part of the macula, where there's a lot of cones that are concentrated, and the cones are responsible for light vision and color vision. And also retinitis pigmentosa, which is a sequential kind of process where the rods are the ones that actually carry the disease and have the mutation degenerate, and then the cones subsequently degenerate as well. And what we see in both of these diseases is that the shedding and renewal process of the photoreceptors gets disturbed in a significant way. And shedding and renewing is like a birth death process where they're able to kind of get rid of any toxicity products that they have. And they're also able to regenerate, and it's a sign of their functionality and vitality. So that's something that we want to focus on. As they start to degenerate, you see their outer segments not getting regenerated, and the rods and the cones start to get just smaller and smaller in length. So that's something that we need to look at. One of the main things that we focus is in the protein known as the ROCK-derived cone viability factor that promotes cone survival. And that protein, the way it works, is actually synthesized by the rods. And then once it's released, it binds to a complex, a BCG1 and GLUT1 complex that allows acceleration of glucose into the cell. So that actually allows external glucose to come in and start the whole metabolic process and be able to meet the metabolic needs of the cones. One of the things that we know about RDCBF in terms of how does it activate GLUT1, which is the main glucose transport into the photoreceptor cells. We know that it actually is an allosteric regulator, which means that it has some characteristics that when you consider that in terms of how that changes with respect to the binding and the activating the GLUT1, it pretty much can, if you were to plot it, it really becomes more like a synodial function. And that allows us to consider modeling the different chemical interactions as a Holland type 3 response function. And in here, this is just an example where the delta and the RN represent the outer segments of the rods, and the delta is the synthesis of the RDCBF. And so that's how we model this allosteric kind of kinetics. And then in terms of how does glucose comes into the cell, we know that there is this gradient that allows it to move into the cell. And like I said, I am going to move very quickly in my research, and also so that I could get to be able to share with you a little bit of my personal story. But that is one of the main things that we are looking at, the different chemical reactions that occur that allow for the photoreceptors to work well. And is this blocking you? I apologize. So if we look at in the model that we consider, one of the models is we consider the irreversible metabolic steps. And those ones are in the purple boxes. And one of the things that is really unique to the photoreceptors is that they behave like cancer cells. And one of the things that they're able to go through the glycolysis process, produce lactate in the presence of oxygen. And that what cancer cells do, one of the things that they're really good at is more than anything is to be able to regenerate and grow. So while they might not be producing that many molecules of ATP, they actually are also at the same time trying to reduce the reactive oxidative species, but also be able to regenerate. And that's what the cones also do, and the photoreceptor and the rods as well. So what we see is that once glucose comes into the cell, it goes from activated glucose inside the cell to becoming G6P. And at that point, there is a diversion where it could either go into the pentose pathway or continue down the glycolysis pathway. And then again, we see a similar kind of diversion in the when we get to the F16 bisphosphate, where things could either continue down the glycolysis pathway or go into the Kennedy pathway. And that's where we have G3P, which is essential to the renewal of the outer segments. Now, one of the things that I should say, that there's feedback mechanisms that are not illustrated here. And for example, like the PEP, once it reaches a certain level, it actually sends a negative feedback loop or signal to G6P and tells the cell to, instead of going down the glycolysis pathway, send it down the pentose pathway. Now we are now modeling PEP. So what do? We actually use the relation of the amount of pyruvate that is in the cell, which is right here, to be able to then create that feedback mechanism in our model explicitly. Now in pyruvate, the pyruvate could also leak into the mitochondria, and that's just a natural process, and that creates a reactive oxidative species. Most of it actually goes into producing lactate and then bringing it out to the cell. And the lactate in there gets utilized by other cells to actually activate and drive their osphos and create their energy. Like the retinal pigment epithelium is one of them. So that's one of the aspects that we model, but we also model the actual cellular process. And here we see it more clearly. Like we have the process that I kind of define of the different metabolites is there's the molecular level, and then we also have the cellular level where we have the cones and the rods feeding from a trophic pool that is mediated by the retinal pigment epithelium cells, right? So that's so we have these two different levels, and there's different time scales that happen because in the molecular level you have things happening very quickly, very fast, and at the cellular level it's a little slower in terms of time. And how do we model those diversions, especially into the pentose pathway? Well, we use the actual pyruvate as an indicator, the relationship in order to be able to send the signal back. But we look at what we call the equilibrium level of PEP, which is the one that will determine, depending on the relationship with pyruvate, whether things will go down the glycolysis pathway or whether they will go down to the pentose pathway. And it's important for glucose to go down the pentose pathway because right there, NADPH is produced, and NADPH actually helps reduce reactive oxidative species because it actually activates the RDCBFL, which is the long form. And the RDCBF long form is produced by both the rods and the cones. So that's, we don't have that much information about the reactive oxidative species, but we are able to model it based on our understanding of how NADPH interacts with it, and also how pyruvate, as a natural process, ends up generating some of it. But we're actually, this is something I'm working with at the NASCA, who is my postdoc, and we're actually trying to do a more realistic model of it, as well as other processes involved. And so we model every single chemical reaction. And for the sake of time, I'm not gonna go into it, but we do have a publication where we model this. And we will have one where we do this particular work. And then I'm gonna introduce another work that we also have published already. So, and here just to pretty much, this is how the production of G6P, again, that is allosteric. So here we see the Holling type 3 functional response curve. And in this case, glucose, the active glucose that went into the cell is the substrate that produces the G6P. So if we looked at all the reaction rates, they're here. We have, in terms of the molecular aspect, we have six variables. Right, in six different reactions that we're addressing, in which, like I said, we produce one of the metabolites, and then that becomes a substrate for the next step. And we focus on our knowledge on physiology to be able to reduce this model and not be able to include every single one of the aspects of the chemical reactions that occur. But then we also have the cellular model combined, and they feed back to each other. And then I should probably go back and explain a little bit. For example, here's where the G6P, the molecular aspect, comes in. And also here in the ROS, right? That's where they come in, and they're coming through the change of the cone's outer segments. Now, how do things feed back into the molecular aspect? Is through the rods. Remember, the rods, the way that GLUK1 is activated and accelerates into the cell, which is a part of this reaction rate right here, is due to the amount of ROS that are out there and the number that synthesize RDCBF. So we have 24 parameters to work with. Some of them we know them, some of them we got them from experimental work, and others ones we have to use data to estimate the parameters. Sorry, then am I going backwards? And so we simulate the model and we're able to capture some of the essential things. For example, in the rods and the cones, there's a 20-to-1 ratio where there's, for every 20 rods there's one cone. And that's very similar to the retina of the mice and the rat and the retina of the humans. And for our data, we use mice data. And also in terms of how many are there in a healthy retina, how many cones, how many rods are there? We were able to get that pretty good. And also the oscillations that happen, which follow a circadian rhythm. We also see the different metabolites oscillate. And the way, and here's just to show us one single day on how we, the data that we use actually transcript data of RDCBF for the cones and RDCBFL that is produced by the rods for the rods in order to be able to be able to validate the model, and also in terms of being able to estimate some of the parameters. And this is just one day, but we have it for longer periods of time. We're not the technology is not there yet where they're able to measure the outer segments. There's a lot of research going in optics to see they're able to use different kind of lasers to measure that in real time, but it hasn't happened yet. And so we have to rely on PRC data. So in our work, we consider different cases. And for the sake of it, I'm only gonna illustrate the one where all the process work properly. So we looked at what happens at different time points, and we did a sensitivity analysis to be able to understand how does the metabolites respond to different changes in the inputs. Right, and then we capture in different time steps, and we compare that to data. And just here, for example, we have the parameters to which the cones are sensitive to, and both whether they have a positive or a negative correlation. And just to give you an example, that also highlights certain things. We see here B max, which is the maximum saturation rate of the Peruve, having this PRC value that is negative, right? But it's sensitive, or really sensitive, or just a little bit. And what that is telling us is that we have the Peruve greater than the PD equilibrium value, then at that point, there's the feedback mechanism that redirects glucose down to the pintose pathway. And that's gonna cause the slowdown on the glucose level, and that's gonna slow down the G3P, which is actually used to create lipids in outer segments. And therefore you're gonna have a decrease in the cones. And we see a similar thing with other parameters, but I'm not gonna go into detail. But one of the things that we do once we do this analysis and we do it for different time steps, we ask which are the key processes that get involved. And what we see is when everything is working properly is aerobic glycolysis, that is actually a process that actually you see the cones being sensitive to different inputs in the parameters, as well as the cone renewal. And here, this is the, when we say the glycolysis process, we're looking at this metabolize here down the glycolysis pathway. And we say, when they say the cone outer segment renewal, we're looking at really the G3P, the processes that are involved there, which are measured by the parameters. And then when we say the competition of resources, is really looking at how the parameters are involving the cones and the rods, by changing their outer segments, but really involving how much they're pulling out from the trophic pool. And we see that there are, this is just to illustrate, but we see that they are involved even at the, when we have 60 minutes and then 14 days. 14 days is because we're working with mice. So that's considered a long time. And that's what we're doing that. And so, and we do that for healthy cones. We do it when there's insufficient use of glucose. We do it when there's insufficient use of RDCBF, when there's no RDCBF. And one of the things that was very striking, even though RDCBF is a very plausible hypothesis of why the cones die, which are very healthy in retinitis pigmentosa, following the rod's death. And we see that RDCBF is only really comes into play when it's insufficient. when there's not sufficient. In other words, we also see that it comes into play when we have really, really low glucose level, when the cell is not really, is almost in a starvation mode from glucose. But when it's working healthy, it is not sensitive at all. And now we asked ourselves, well, what happens if we further reduce our DCBF by 40%? What happens? Well, how does the different metabolites in the cell change? And many of them actually, and the blue one is really just the baseline, right? And then the green one or the light green is actually the amount of changes that you see, but looking at our sensitivity analysis through that. And what we see is that the one where there's not really much change, or where the one that is, that plays a big role is G3P, and I'm sorry, not sensitivity analysis, is looking at the change of the impact. And we see that GP3 does not get affected. Also the rods and the trophic pool, and that's natural because the rods and the pool, trophic pool are not really being driven by our DCBF. But GP3, that causes us to stop and pause. Everything else is being affected, yet GP3, which is the precursor of lipids, is not affected at all. And so we really asked ourselves what happened. And that leads to the next work that involves my collaborators that I mentioned. And we now need to think about what other sources of fuel drives the metabolic system of a cone, right? And in this case, what we're gonna consider not just what happens internally in glycolysis, but we're also gonna consider the oxidation of fatty acids that are used to produce beta hydropurates that come in and actually fuel the system and provide that kind of a energy to be able to create more energy, that provide that, I guess, the injection of metabolites or alternative metabolites to create energy. And we also have to look at lactate from other cells that comes in and also provides that kind of support. So with that, we consider, but how do we actually reduce the model even further to be able to do a little bit more analysis or understand what are the driving mechanisms? So we just consider a single cone and the feedback, the connections between the RPE and the rods, we use proxies within the cone metabolized to be able to do that feedback mechanism. For example, the fatty acid oxidation, which really comes from the shed outer segments that are phagocytosis and from the RPE, we actually just measure them with the production of GP3 and a scaling factor to be able to get some kind of measurement on that alpha and then feed it back into there. Sorry. And for our DCBF, a similar kind of thing we do. One of the things that we did here is an improvement on this gating function, not just the diffusive way in which glucose comes in that allows it to come in, but that there is no backflow, but also the way the lactate comes out of the cell. And depending on what the lactate condition is inside the cell, it will actually come back out. But we're looking at external lactate in comparison with the internal lactate for that. And we have different pathways that we are considering, and we have our system of equations. While there's less equations, it's still very nonlinear. So we have to resort to more of the numerical simulations to be able to analyze it. And we have many parameters, less than before, but still quite a few. And again, we use some of the literature parameters that have been there given from experimental work, and we also try to estimate them. One of the things that we found in this system is that we have bistability for a certain regime or parameters where either everything completely continues to die out, it's like a pathological state, or where things actually are very healthy. And we do we do bifurcation analysis to try to understand more of the long-term run effects. But what I wanna focus here is to be able to do a little bit of comparison is the sensitivity analysis that we worked on. And we did, we use Latin hyperQ space sampling as before to get the PRC values. And we also use the EFAS, which is a variance-based method. The PRCC measures how the different inputs will impact the output, and the EFAS really measures how the uncertainty in the inputs or the parameters will be reflected on the variability of the outputs. And that's very important because there's certain parameters that we are not, that we, even if we're getting it from experiments, we might, there might be some kind of error in there that we need to be able to then be very considerate and be very careful on how we're gonna actually measure them and make sure that they're as accurate as possible. The ones that have, that where EFAS has the index is very high. And then also for the ones that are the PRC, to be able to see which ones are the ones that are really driving the system or the for, to which ones the system is sensitive to. So we do that. We actually do, we consider when we have low glucose, we look at 0.02 millimoles, and we consider also the initial glucose being 2 millimoles. And then we look at, we do sensitivity analysis at one point at time 240 minutes. And we see that what EFAS gives, EFAS indicates that alpha, which is again the oxidation of fatty acids, is the thing that the cones are sensitive to. PRCC gives alpha, but gives additional information, external glucose, and as well as the maximum half rate of pyruvate, and then the saturation level of G3P. And then we say, well, what happens if you look at a time series, right, from beginning to the 140 minutes. Which are the things that are actually playing a role? We see that alpha continues to play a role, the oxidation of fatty acids, but we also see some of the parameters that happen at that point, obviously. But we see that initially, the first, from 0 to 50 minutes, we see a few of them being sensitive, the system being sensitive to. And that allows us to then further explore and say, well, not just what kind of mechanisms or processes we need to alter to slow down the progression of the cone degeneration, but how long do we have to be able to play with them a little bit? So, and this is, like I said, this is just an external thing. With bifurcation analysis, and this is preliminary work that we've been working on, we're able to see, again, we have bistability, and we look at when we have healthy state only and also the pathological state. And here we're looking at external glucose and again, alpha, the oxidation of fatty acids. And that this is here bifurcation said, we now consider what happened if the efficiency of GLUT1 measured by the parameter lambda is changed. And what we see is if we change it, we decrease it. What we see is we go from the orange or red curve that you see here to the yellow to the green. And what that is saying is if you take a particular value of, let's say, external glucose, so that's all that the cell is really able to have, right? Then as the actual efficiency of GLUT1 to bring glucose into the cell is decreasing, then alpha, the oxidation of fatty acids is gonna have to increase to be able to, again, allow you to walk into the bistability region where you actually could achieve a healthy state. And then we also look at what happens with the different levels of external glucose. And what's interesting is that for GP3, right, the different levels, here we have two saturnal bifurcations connecting with each other. And at any given point, if you take a cut, that will give you the bistability, right? But it allows you to see that as you're varying your glucose, your internal glucose, how that also impacts the change in alpha, right? And how that will turn out to impact the level of GP3, which is, again, responsible for this renewal and shedding. But there's a lot of things that we're able to see here. We're able to see the importance of external glucose, lactate, and oxidation of fatty acids. They're key under starvation conditions where the cell doesn't have the glucose to drive it. And we continue to explore different mechanisms, but currently we're looking at the relationship. What does this mean in terms of retinal disease? And what is the role of retinal pigment epithelium, right? And can this be captured in a single cone model, or do we have to go to the next level, which is really bring the retinal pigment epithelium as its own unit and model the metabolic processes in there. So that's where we are in terms, and I know this was a big summary, so let me now go to my personal talk. I know it was very fast. How many minutes do I have, Emil?
You have, let's say 15 or 20 minutes, maybe 15 minutes.
Total?
No, before we go into questions.
Okay.
Would that be enough or?
No, that should be okay. That should be fine. I guess I wanted to highlight research because one of the things that I noticed in my trajectory is that many times women, we think of them as great educators, great mentors. And sometimes we don't think of them as doing research. And depending on the type of institution focus that we have, we all love doing research because that's how we ended up getting our PhDs, right? But there's other passions that we have as well. So I wanted to talk about that a little bit about my research first. And now if you allow me, I'll share with you So I'll go ahead and, so this is a little bit about my trajectory. And it's a talk that I put together for NSF, but one of the things that I think my trajectory really reflects as I look back where I started and where I am is really the systemic changes of the system that really allowed me to go forward. Without them, I wouldn't have been able to do that, right? And many times we talk about equality or things being equitable, but that only works and we have to change them every so often depending on what individuals we're talking about. But it's only when we really remove systemic barriers that we create a universal design that could work for everyone. And I think that's something that I'm very passionate about doing, and that's something that I've been able to do more at the NSF. So a little bit about me. I was born in Mexico. I'm the fourth child in my family. My father died when I was 3 months old, leaving my sixth grade educated mother with four kids to raise under the age of five. So for me, growing up, I couldn't understand many things. I couldn't understand why we had so many hardships, why sometimes there was not enough food to eat, or why we had to dance or celebrate our birthdays all at once when we had really different birthdays of a month, right? And why my mom had to work multiple jobs to support us. I couldn't really understand, and I think but now I understand it was really part of a bigger plan, because thanks to that, background, I'm able to understand some of the challenges that my students have. And I'm able to then take a different approach. Another experience that really has impacted the things I do is coming to this country. So I was an immigrant. I was 8 when I came to this, to the United States. It was a foreign place for me, right? And I grew up in South Central, and then we moved to East LA. So I grew up in a place full of gangs and violence. And if you ever see the movie Colors, which is already a little old, that's really the neighborhoods where I grew up and the life that I kind of had for a while. And I think really that experience of feeling like a foreigner repeated time after time when I went into graduate school, when I became a faculty, even walking into the National Science Foundation, right? Feeling like I'm I come from a different perspective and trying to understand and trying to navigate the system. Being very excited, but at the same time being very afraid. So the environment and the social factors around me really shaped my experience, really shaped, you know, how I see things. My three older siblings had to drop out of high school, and it was not really a choice. It's just that we didn't have enough money to pay the rent. And many times we were gonna be kicked out of our 2-bedroom apartment. And so they had to go out and get jobs. I was second to the youngest, so I was very lucky. And I always consider myself very lucky. And I think that's why I work really hard, because they didn't have the opportunity I had, right? To be able to finish. But poverty, hardship, and stereotypes really make aspiration low, right? So for me, my biggest dream was to be a cashier, because I didn't want it to be cleaning toilets like my mom did. My mom cleaned houses, cleaned banks, and I would go with her in the nights. She also sold food in the parks illegally. So and I saw how hard she worked, and we still couldn't make it in terms of sometimes we couldn't pay the rent. Sometimes I remember doing my homework with a candle because we had no electricity and it was late at night. So for me, being a cashier would be like the pinnacle of what could I strive for, right? Well, little did I know that I had more, way more. And it's when I encounter my catalyst of change, Jaime Escalante, that things really change for me. And I just want to share with you.
Well, not too bad. Erika, good.
And I show that because people ask me, do you really have Jaime Escalante? Yes, I did. I actually found some videos. And here, there's in the, and I remember very clearly one of the things that he really did, he really inspired me to do better, right? And it was through humor, discipline, and having high expectations. Is the Zoom blocking your view? No?
We can see your slides.
Oh, thank you, because yes. With me, I'm moving it around.
Then, the way to success, success means victory, does not come easily. If you believe in yourself, you're gonna do it. Believing in yourself means you're building confidence. Believing in yourself is a giant step to success. You're gonna do it.
So you were, you were in the movie?
You see?
No, I was not in the movie. The movie came before the time that I was in high school and that I met Jaime Escalante. But there was a series of videos that were created. It was Who Needs Math? Who Needs It? And I was part of those videos. But I did have him as a teacher for, almost 2 years. And then he had to leave to another school. And that's when I had other math instructors and mentors. But let me just finish.
How you do that? That's a top secret. It is a top secret. You see, it's easy, it's simple. Anybody could do it. The only thing you need in this class is ganas.
And he was correct. All you need is ganas. Ganas means desire, the desire to succeed, right? And that's all you need. I remember he would bring different students to talk about their experience who were now engineers working for different companies, right? And one time this student came who went to MIT. And I remember after, I was so inspired by that student because not only did he talk about the work he did, he talked about the house he lived in, the neighborhood, which is a nicer neighborhood than where we live in. So I remember at the end, I said, Kimo, because we would call him Kimo, like Kimo Sabe, for the one who knows it all. And I said, Kimo, I want to go to that MIT. And he goes, no flaca. He would call me the skinny one. No flaca. It's called MIT. I said, well, yeah, I want to go to that place. And he said, if you stick with me, I'll take you all the way to MIT. Well, fast forward. I ended up at Wellesley College, an all women's school in Massachusetts. And every time I felt like it didn't fit in, where I really felt like I just wanted to pack my stuff and go home, I would call Jaime Escalante. I would not call my mom because my mom would tell me, I don't know why you went so far. You could have gone to ELA Community College. You know, so many people have gone there and they've done good. But they did not understand that I wanted something different, that I wanted to really have the experience that I would have never had. But I would call Jaime, and Jaime Escalante, he would start very hard. He would say, you were given an opportunity that no one was given. The minute you give up, you would shut the door for everyone. So you cannot quit now and stop crying. You know, you have nothing to cry. You have an opportunity that no one has. So I always felt like he was right. You know, if I'm given the opportunity, I better do my best so that others could come, so that they would give others a chance. But then he would start to joke around. And I reminded him one time, I said, remember, Kimo, you said you were going to take me to MIT. Well, here I am in a liberal arts college with all women, and it's not really about technology. That's not the focus, right? It's more of a liberal arts education. He said, oh, come on, flaca. I'm just human. I'm not an exact science. I overshot by what? 40 miles? Or, because we were very close. And fast forward, you know, sometimes things come not in the way that we want them or the shape we expect them. 20 years later, I was walking out of my apartment in Somerville, and my husband stopped me because he knew I had tears in my eyes. And he said, Tatiana. And then I look up and said, Kimo would have been really proud of you because he took you all the way to MIT. So that day, it was my first lecture in MIT. And I remember I got there early. I sat on that chair and I waited for everyone to come. So everyone's almost waiting for the professor to come. Once everyone is there, I get up and I said, wow, I waited 20 years to sit on that chair, but I'm here and it feels better to be up on the board. And I told them a little bit about my story. And I said, you were given an opportunity that I wanted, but I didn't get. So we better make the best out of this experience. And so I always think that that inspired them, because then they realized that, well, yeah, they're in this elitist place, but they don't understand that also other people are looking at them and want that opportunity, or are looking at them to make a difference. So that was part of the opportunity. And I think, and I going to Wellesley, there was a lot of lack of diversity. I didn't really look like most of the students, but the lack of diversity was really an opportunity for me, because it really allowed me to look beyond. But it was not easy. It was hard. I was constantly reminded that I was there just to fulfill a quota, right? And even as a freshman, when I was taking my physics course, my lab partner, when she found out I was from Mexico, she didn't want to work with me. Because initially, I guess she thought I was from France or someplace in Europe because I had an accent. And once she found out I was from Mexico, she said that she wouldn't work with me because people like me would bring her grade down. When I talked to the professor, the physics professor, and he said, I wouldn't blame her. I would not work with you either. I don't know why we keep in accepting individuals like you. And at this point, it was the first week of class. So I don't think any kind of a sign of what kind of student I was. So I had to do all my experiments by myself. And initially I would, other students would laugh because they would see me running back and forth because there was a measurement I had to take and then I had to do the experiment. So I started to feel embarrassed. So I would go in the night after midnight, you know, when no one was there, to do the experiments. And sometimes I would recruit some of my friends from social science or Latin American studies to come and help me do the experiments. So I tried really hard, but I still got a C in that class. And at that point I realized, well, being an engineer is not for me, even though it was my dream. And I wish I wouldn't have said that, because I always tell my students, don't let one course or one professor define your path. But I did. Right. But I'm glad because I still follow the passion of mathematics and things that make sense for me. And I had similar experience as a sophomore, where I would work with an infirmary and the nurse would tell me that her daughter couldn't get in because someone like me took her spot. And similar with math professor. Right. When I was going to graduate school, I really admired this math professor. And I asked her for a letter of recommendation. And she said that She would not recommend me going to graduate school, that I should just be content with getting a bachelor's and getting a teaching credential. So I learned that many times, you know, we put stereotypes on people and we don't know where they're gonna get or how they're gonna do. Because I think I've been one of the very few, one of the successful students, right? But we still put those stereotypes. And it was really an RU experience that changed my perspective in terms of allowing me to see that I could go to graduate school and I could do something that was relevant. And I found my passion in doing mathematical biology because I could really put mathematics to use in a way that I could explain it to others and explain it to my parents, who always said, my dad would say, when are you gonna graduate? You know, you've been in school more than anyone that I know around here. And all you're gonna do is become a teacher. So I don't understand why you keep on going to school. He did not understand that it was not to be a teacher, it was to be a professor. But not having anyone that got their PhD in my entire extended family, my parents did not understand what that meant. But I was able to go and then do for others what I wish my professors would have done for me, right? Many times people ask, what is the thing that make you such a great mentor? I think that I look at the path and the experience, and I want to change that for others. And I'm very genuine about that, right? But really overcoming things is not really changing the culture, changing the practices, and really creating access for everyone is not easy. It's very difficult. There's a lot of structures that prevent that, even though individuals are very well intentioned, right? But I've been fortunate because it's through the thing that I'm passionate about, creating opportunities, that I've been able to be validated, even when sometimes certain institutions don't validate service, right? I've been validated in a way that means a lot to me. I mean, for example, just at the NSF, this week, I got an email from a potential PI, and she sent me an email and she said that she had given up hope in terms of being able to get grants and being able to be part of the reviewers. And she said, and I interacted with you once and you've been sending me all these opportunities and you've been really helpful. And I hope I'm not stepping out of line and being unprofessional. But she said, but you really, I had not met someone like you. And I just want to thank you. And I think that meant a lot, because sometimes my colleagues would say, why you stay up late so late to answer emails? And I just don't want to be the other person on the other side and feel like someone is ignoring me. So lately I haven't been answering emails because I've been moving. I've been in a very stressful situation, but when I'm not, I try my best to answer emails and be there for others. And but really getting to where I got is not just my own merit. It's really the approach of others in the community and the support that I had as well. So it's really a dual approach. I wouldn't have been able to make it without the support that I had from my professors, from women that I met that are in mathematical biology and that I admire so much, and from my peers that now become my mentors. But really creating pathways and breaking stereotypes is not easy, right? And also bringing your culture to an environment that doesn't know it, right? Like, for example, I went to graduate school. I would get a lot of pressure to have my first son, and I did for my family, right? But that came with a very high price. It was very, very difficult. So I ended up getting divorced, right? And then I think my son had some moments of instability a lot. And I felt very guilty almost my entire for his entire life until he went to college, and I'm packing his stuff and everything. He went to Arizona State University, but I'm concerned that he might change his mind. And then he asked me, mom, stop, sit down for a minute. And I thought he was gonna, mom, go to college. And all he said is, thank you. And thank you for everything you've done. Because, you know, I know that you made a lot of sacrifices because you were so afraid to go into a place or put us in a place where we would be poor like you were. But in reality, what you've shown us is that you could do if you get an education. It's a lot. Because many times I ask myself, should I have quit graduate school and take care of my kid? And what I mean by that is because once I got divorced, he went to Los Angeles with his dad and my mom helped babysit and my sister. So I went back to Cornell when he was 10 months old. I was not there to witness his first word or his first steps. And I would go every 4 weeks, but it would be very painful because the whole flight back, I would be crying because I would hear him scream. And this is when they would allow you to go all the way up to the gate, right? And I would wait until they would tell me, ma'am, you have to go in, we have to close the door. And so it would be very painful. But I knew that if I transferred to another university, I would not finish, right? So, like I said, it's really my whole support of mentors and role models that really have inspired me. And I have had them all along the way from high school all the way until graduate school, until now that I'm a faculty, and I continue to reach out to them. And some of them are my peers, right? And really it's about, they allow me to keep on going. They allow me to really be driven by wanting to change, you know, the systemic barriers, remove them, and really create inclusion for everyone. So I have had a huge opportunity. Now I'm at the National Science Foundation, right? And when I interview, I gotta be honest with you, I didn't think I was gonna have the job, right? There was a meeting that I had where I had to meet with the committee for an hour. No one showed up. So I thought, and then of course later on they were very apologetic. So I thought this was probably just a check, right? but I actually ended up getting the position, and it has been an incredible experience. I learned a lot. But with that, I'll stop sharing, and thank you so much.
Wow. Thank you so much, Erika. Wow. I'm just trying to get my words together because I really, really appreciate how vulnerable you were and sharing your experiences. I really enjoyed the research talk, and I also really enjoyed hearing about your personal story. So thank you so much.